Hi class, it's Bill Berry with another intro to a chapter, and this one is chapter 6 on file IO and exceptions. Our programs as we move through the quarter are getting more and more powerful. They feel more and more like full-featured programs, and this chapter will make a huge difference in what you feel you can do. So I hope this will be a fun one for you, and let's jump in and get started. So here's what we're going to look at today. We'll talk about the basics of file input and output and what are some general things that you need to know. These things are generically useful in other programming languages. They'll be very similar in a lot of cases, so you'll have a good basis for that. We'll also talk about how you can use loops to get in data from a file that already exists. And we'll talk about also exceptions, which we'll probably do in another video, and we won't actually cover those in the same week potentially, because I think we have a second week to work on this, so we'll get started and probably stop there. So, here are some basics about file input and output. First of all, many times our programs need to save data that needs to persist or it needs to last longer than just one run of the program in memory. When you exit the program, any data that you had stored in variables and later you'll learn lists, anything like that, that stuff all goes away. It goes out of memory and it's just gone. And so many programs need to store some data so that they can get it back the next time the program runs. It's very, very typical. So that's why we're studying these things right now. We're going to use a very simple example of files that are stored on our local hard drive. We're not going to get fancy about storing things on the web or anything like that, although in a lot of cases it's not greatly harder. So basically, though, there are many different types of files that you may want to deal with, and these include basic text files, like fairly human readable, right, that you could open in Notepad and actually look at them. But then there are also binary files that are, in essence, they're often reflections of what you have in memory. They're kind of dumps of what you had in memory, and they are not going to be human readable. They're going to be look like gibberish to you if you try to look at them. But programs can certainly read them, and often they're more compact that way as well. Now, within those types, again, we're going to focus on text files. It just makes it easier, and we're introducing the topic. No sense getting hard right away. The second thing is, there's two ways that we could access files. One is called a sequential file, and that is that you consider the file just a series of pieces of information that you're interested in, and you read them one after another. Now, this makes life easy and easy to understand, which is great for us for the moment, but it makes it a little harder because it means if you want to read the 100th record, you still got to read 99 records before you get to the 100th one. But again, for simplicity's sake, let's start easy and we're going to do sequential. Now, there are random access files where you can get right to the record that you're interested in. We're not going to cover those in this particular quarter, but you will no doubt run into those soon enough in another class. Now, here are some basic things that you need to know. If you're ready to open a file or you're aiming toward that direction, here's some preparatory knowledge that you're going to need. First of all, you're going to need the name of the file, and very often you're going to want the full path to the file with, you know, C:\, or wherever this is going to live on disk. So you need to have the file name, and you might as well have the full path in case you need that. Second, when you open a file, it's going to return a file object from that call. And that file object is going to be pointed to by a variable of your design, of your choosing. So you need to create a variable and you're going to store the result of the first open call in it, and that's going to be the file object sort of reference. And basically you're going to use that reference everywhere where you work on the file, right? That becomes sort of the handle, that becomes the thing that you refer to do a file operation. So you're going to use that in the future. Notice the name of the file gets only used once, but this file reference is going to be used all the time. Next thing is, when you open the file, you need to tell it what kind of operation you're going to do on the file, what kind of mode you want to open it in. And in Python, there's three, and this is again very typical in other languages. You can read from the file, that means the file has to exist. You can write to the file, which means write over a file, or create a new file, because you're going to write data into it. Or you can append data into the file. The A stands for append. And you can add to an existing file, or if it doesn't find the file, it's happy enough to create a new one. So those are the three kinds of modes that you can use. And at the bottom of this slide, you see some examples. So the first one says patient file. equals open, right, the keyword, the function, built-in function called open. Then you tell it the name of the file. This is assuming it knows how to find that file, which basically is going to mean it needs to be right next to the program on disk. And then after a comma, you put in quotes the mode. In this case, we're going to write to the file. Again, if that file already exists, it's going to write over it and start from scratch. Second example is hobby file equals open. You put the name of the file with the full path in this example, but notice that that is preceded by an R. We've never seen that before, probably in Python, but this indicates that this is a raw string. And you're telling Python, hey, I'm going to put some things in here that might confuse you, like backslashes, but I don't want you to interpret these as special escape characters like backslash n for new line and things like that. Treat this as a raw string and do no processing on it before you store it. So that's the name of the path, the full path to the file, including the file name, and the R says it's a raw file. Then, very last on the line, you have an R saying, I want to read from that file. So this is what you need to know to open a file, and then, as I said before, you're going to use that file reference, a file variable that you created, the thing on the left of the equal sign in these examples. You're going to use that in the future when you want to read and write to the file. So let's look at how you do that. First of all, to write to a file, you use the file reference, the file variable, and then a dot, and then the write method. And inside the write method, you're going to say whatever you want to write to the file. Now, it's fairly typical that you want one thing per line, because it's very easy when you read the thing back later to read it in one line at a time, and then you know it's one complete thing. It doesn't mean you have to do that, but that's a very typical way to do it. It just makes life a little bit easier. So in this first line, we're writing John Doe, and then notice we're putting a backslash n on that literal so that we make sure that there is a new line that's going to be created. Notice that the write method doesn't automatically make a new line, so you have to add it. Also notice John Doe is 43 years old, so we want to go and write that to the file, and we have to make that into a string because we're going to concatenate a backslash n again to that. So we first make it into a string, we concatenate the backslash n, put that together and write it out to the file. So after these two lines and subsequent ones that write patient names, you're going to see that the file looks like the example on the far right, John Doe, and then there's a new line character, and then 43, and a new line character, and you're going to keep writing out patients. Now, notice that this is a very loose affiliation between the patient name and the patient age. They come one after another, but they are not particularly put together in a magic way, so when you read them back, you've got to read them in pairs, just like you wrote them in pairs when you are writing them to the file. Hopefully that makes sense. Now the next examples right under the or here is shows you how you'd use variables to do that, but it's the same thing. You basically have to tack on the backslash n's, and in this case we've used concatenation to just put that together and write that to the file. Now, the general form of reading from a file is very straightforward. You can use the name of the file reference rather, and then the read line method, and then you put a variable, and it's going to read an entire line up to the backslash n, including the backslash n, and it's going to put it in the variable that you have stored there. So in this case, you're going to do, actually this has an error in the code, so let's fix that at this point. I believe in this case what we want is more like this. That makes a lot more sense, because that wouldn't make sense to do it in that order. So let's say that's a corrected slide that looks better. Sorry about that. So redo a read line and then store it in the hobby name. But then realize that you're going to have a backslash n left over that's still on that string, and you may want to strip it off for future processing so it doesn't get included. So of course we can say hobby name equals hobby name dot write strip, R strip, and tell it you want to strip off backslash n's, but nothing else. You don't want to take away anything else from the string. So that's a typical pair. Read it in, strip off the backslash n. Then you have the same problem here. I don't know where I got this, but we're going to read line and we're going to call that, and then we're going to store the result in hobby years. So read line and then do hobby years. But notice again that's got an extra backslash n and it's a string. So if we want it to be an integer, first of all we have to write strip the backslash n off the string, and then we convert that to an integer, store it back in hobby years. So these are some fairly typical lines that you're going to see here. You're going to write and read with these kinds of commands. So hopefully that makes sense to you. All right, now let's say we already have the stuff in a file. How do we now go read it back? You've got a whole bunch of patients or a whole bunch of hobbies. So let's assume that we have a file called myhobbies.txt that's stored in the gyms files directory, and it has pairs of hobby names and then how long you've been doing that hobby, kind of like we did with a patient file. Well, so let's look at the lines, and we've got the same errors here, so forgive me, I will go and correct those as we go. This is real-time material creation here, sorry about that. Let's go take this, we'll take this and copy, paste, cut, paste. There we go, that looks a lot better. Okay, better. All right, so we have the file. We're going to go and open the file. On the top line, we're going to save a file variable called hobby file. Then we're going to use hobby name. Again, one more example of this done in the wrong order. Sorry about that. Let's cut that and paste it. Programming is an iterative thing, and you should never make slides without running the code yourself to make sure that it is correct. So there we go. There's our lesson. Okay, so back to the lesson here. We open the hobby file. We save the file handle. Hobby file, then we do a read line and we store that in the hobby name because that's the first thing we expect in the file. This is called a priming read, right? You got to try one read and that kind of gets the loop started and going. Now, one of the things that I note in the testing note below is always test with an empty file to make sure your code works with that. The first time through it may be empty or something unexpected may happen. You don't want your code to blow up. So this notice that the priming read, as we'll see here, we know we're at the end of the file when we do a read line and the thing that comes back is an empty string. So in this case, this code should work perfectly with an empty file. Then we can do a loop that says while hobby name is not equal to empty string, then we just keep processing. So we strip off the backslash n, we read the next line and store the years, we strip off the backslash n and convert years to an integer, store it in hobby years, and then notice we need to get the next line. And this print statement is also out of place because it prints it after we do the next read, and that is incorrect. That would be another bug in our code. So after we get the years and convert it, we print those two things, and then this is typical of a loop. Remember, we did the priming read at the top, so very last thing in the loop before we get to the outside of the loop, last line in the loop, we do another read. That's the loop that's going to read in pairs, and when the file is done, we're going to get a hobby name that's an empty string, the loop will stop, life is happy, and then of course we want to be good citizens and close the file. So outside of the loop, we're done processing, we do hobbyfile.close, and then we're done. Hopefully that makes some sense. Now, I want to show you one other example where things are a little bit different, and in fact, this is a cool thing that happens in Python. Sorry, we have the same exact error here. There we go. All right, so one thing that you can do in Python that's very cool is that you can use a for loop to read it. I don't remember, can't think of offhand, one single language that lets you treat files as a collection like this, a sequence of lines. Very, very cool and convenient. So look how easy it is. If we just want to read and write lines out of a file, we of course open the file as usual. We have the hobby file reference. And then we don't even need a priming read. That's another error here, sorry. We don't need a priming read at all. We open the file and then we simply say for, give it some variable that represents a line, and then in hobby file. We don't need a priming read, we don't need a condition, we don't need anything. It's going to go through the file, read in each line one at a time, and do everything that's in the body of the for loop. In this case, it's just going to print the thing, and then when we're done, we close the file. It's pretty amazing. There's no variables, no conditions. I mean, it's so small an amount of code. Now, this assumes that every line is sort of undifferentiated, that it's just a bunch of lines. So if you wanted to do something special to treat them differently, you'd have to figure out how to, you know, make one type of field and one another. But I just want to show you the construction, which is kind of an interesting thing here. Now, a couple of notes. There's some really good example code, and you're going to want to read it. It's going to help you. This is section 6.3 on processing records. It gives you some examples of how you'd add records, search for records, delete records, modify records. All of that's really interesting stuff, and it's good for you to have that in your brain of how you might want to do that. And, oh, that might help when it comes to, say, an upcoming assignment as well. Now, one of the things that all of this is probably creating in you, I hope it's creating in you, is some sort of extra hunger, because one of the things we've realized by doing this is we do these little loops where we read in data and we process them, but then at the end of the loop, poof, it's all kind of done and gone. What if I needed those records around a little while longer? What if I didn't want to just have one at a time? What if I needed all of them? What if I want to store all of them in memory so that I can do something more interesting, like maybe I can sort them, or maybe I can look them up in memory, which is a lot faster than looking them up one at a time in the file. So this, if you're feeling that kind of hunger, you're on exactly the right track, and this is a great prelude to something that we're going to study in an upcoming chapter, and that is lists, where we could do exactly that and store these all in memory. So keep that thought, keep that hunger, and we will satisfy that hunger in a next chapter coming up. All right, so I think we're going to stop there, because the exception topic, again, we may split into a different week altogether, and it's a whole topic unto itself, just happens to be in this chapter. So hopefully you've got a good sense now as to what are some of the basic things you need to do with files. It'll really expand your program's ability to do cool stuff, so I hope you'll practice with this, play with the examples, have fun with it, and of course, as usual, ask questions on the forums or in email if you have them, and thanks for watching the video.